Gout is the most common inflammatory arthritis. Gout is caused by excess of uric acid in our organism. Basically, at some point, the amount of uric acid in our tissues becomes so huge that uric acid crystallizes and precipitates. And in form of crystals, uric acid progressively accumulates in the tissues and causes some clinical symptoms. So to explain why gout develops, we have to recall uric acid metabolism. So when cells die, the inner content is released into the blood, including nucleus. Then nuclear membrane undergo degradation with release of intranuclear content, which is DNA. DNA molecule is composed of purines and pyrimidines. Purines are adenine and guanine. Then adenine and guanine undergo conversion to hypoxanthine, and hypoxanthine undergo oxidation, which is provided by the specific enzyme called xanthine oxidase. As a result, xanthine is produced. Then xanthine, again by xanthine oxidase, is converted into the uric acid, and the uric acid is excreted by the kidneys into the urine. But some portion of uric acid can be reabsorbed into the blood. This reabsorption is provided by the uric acid transporter 1. Why uric acid is important for us? It turns out that increasing uric acid can be dangerous. Uric acid is a poor soluble molecule, and because of this, uric acid easily precipitates with formation of uric acid crystals. The signature feature of uric acid crystals is a needle shape. The formation of uric acid crystals in the kidney tubules can cause formation of kidney stones, and the accumulation of uric acid stones in the kidney tubules at some point can cause acute kidney injury. In addition to this, accumulation of uric acid crystals in the joints can cause inflammation of the joints, a condition known as gout. Gout has four phases. It's asymptomatic phase, when person has just very high uric acid level. It's acute flare, due to the inflammasome activation. It's a phase where most severe inflammation occurs. It's intercritical phase, basically it's post-inflammatory phase. And it's chronic phase, or we call this chronic gout, when tophi develops. So how gout develops? When a lot of uric acid accumulates in the tissue, uric acid molecule binds to another uric acid molecule and form uric acid crystals. In kidney tissue, uric acid crystals can form a uric acid stone. In other tissues, usually deposition of uric acid crystals causes formation of a tophus. Tophi can develop in various sites, but most commonly tophus develops on ear, on the elbow, and on the finger palms. Here we see a huge tophus on the digit. Usually, gout remains in the chronic phase, so all these uric acid crystals will be just the components of the tophus. But at some point, inside the joint, when macrophages phagocyte uric acid crystals, huge amount of uric acid crystals can trigger activation of inflammasome inside the macrophages. With activation, inflammasome begin to produce interleukin 1, interleukin 6, and tumor necrosis factor alpha. All of them are pro-inflammatory mediators that activate neutrophils. Neutrophils come to uric acid crystals where they try to phagocyte them. This creates huge local inflammation inside the joint. We call this state acute flare. Severe local inflammation causes sudden excruciating pain inside the joint. Also, inflammation manifests with joint redness, tenderness, and joint edema. In addition to this, inflammation causes local and systemic increase in temperature. When inflammation resolves, acute flare basically comes back to a chronic phase, and all these uric acid crystals will be just a part of the tophus. This process of chronic phase, acute flare, chronic phase is repeated cyclically time after time. We have two most common factors that cause increase in uric acid crystallization. The first one is low temperature. It's the reason why gout more commonly develops in peripheral joints compared to the proximal joints. And the second factor is previous trauma to the joint. It's the reason why gout most commonly affects first metatarsophalangeal joint, because it's a weight-bearing joint that undergoes the most severe mechanical stress. So, as we said, the major reason why gout develops is very high level of uric acid in the blood. So, which factors can cause increase in uric acid level? The first group of factors is factors that cause increase in uric acid production. First of all, it's myeloid and lymphoproliferative disorders. Because with increasing amount of blood cells, their turnover increase. So the greater amount of DNA molecules will enter into the blood. Thereby, the greater amount of uric acid will be produced. Also, it's cytotoxic medication. Because cytotoxic drugs can cause increase in cellular death rate. The greater amount of cells die, the greater is the release of DNA molecule into the blood. Thereby, the greater amount of uric acid will be produced. The most common factor that causes increase in uric acid level is intake of food with high concentration of purines. It's alcohol, especially beer, meat and fish. The higher the consumption of purines, the greater will be the production of uric acid. The second group of factors is factors that decrease the excretion of uric acid. The major factor is acute or chronic renal failure. Because with decrease in renal excretion, the greater amount of uric acid will remain in the circulation. And also diuretics, because most of diuretics decrease the secretion of uric acid into the urine. Additional factor is acidosis, because both lactic acidosis and ketoacidosis stimulate uric acid transporter 1, and by this they increase the reabsorption of uric acid into the blood. The greater amount of uric acid will be reabsorbed, the greater will be the concentration of uric acid in the blood. So alcohol, especially beer, high protein food and acids as aspirin cause increase in uric acid level. With increase in uric acid level, the amount of uric acid crystals will increase. The higher the amount of uric acid crystals, the higher the chance of inflammasome activation that will cause massive cytokines production. The higher the amount of pro-inflammatory cytokines, the higher will be the amount of neutrophils that will come into the joint, and thereby the more severe will be the inflammation. So all acute flare symptoms will be more severe. Also, in chronic phase, the higher the amount of uric acid crystals, the higher is the risk of uric acid stones formation in the kidney, and also the higher will be the rate of tophus formation. So, which laboratory methods we can use in gout? First of all, we have to determine uric acid level in the blood, because high uric acid level is the major reason why gout develops. Also, we can take joint aspiration and on microscope, we can determine a needle-shaped negatively birefringent crystals. So here we see a sample of joint fluid with needle-shaped negatively birefringent crystals. What do we mean by negatively birefringent? Basically, when uric acid crystals are aligned parallel to the ray of light, they have yellow color. And when they aligned across the direction of polarization, they have blue color. So simply speaking, negatively birefringent means that we see yellow-blue colored crystals. Also, as a major diagnostic method, we use X-ray of the joint. So on this X-ray, we see multiple erosions at metatarsophalangeal joints on both foot. If we compare a healthy joint to the affected joint, the difference is huge. Also, we see affected first distal intraphalangeal joint. And if we compare this joint to the same joint from the left, we also see dramatic difference. As we see, other distal intraphalangeal joints from the both sides are also affected. Severe inflammation inside the first metatarsophalangeal joints caused massive soft tissue swelling around the joint. On complete blood count, we also can determine inflammation by increasing white blood cells, increasing ESR, and increasing C-reactive protein. In clinical medicine, to diagnose gout, we use gout criteria. As we see, the first step is to determine symptoms of acute flare, because it's the most symptomatic phase. Actually, we have a lot of cartoon pictures that can help us to remember how acute flare of gout looks like. Here we see a typical gout location that affects first metatarsophalangeal joint. And the second picture helps us to remember that the most common reason why acute flare develops is diet. The second step is to determine by joint aspiration the presence of needle-shaped negatively birefringent crystals, which is the hallmark of gout. When you see such crystals, 99% is gout. So both these criteria can be used for acute flare. If gout is long-lasting, it causes formation of tophus, and the presence of tophus is also the hallmark of gout. Next criteria are clinical. First of all, they tell us that acute flare of gout most commonly develops in weight-bearing first metatarsophalangeal joints, and acute flare usually causes erythema, tenderness, and pain around the joint. The next criteria tell us that gout is chronic disorder, and as any chronic disorder, gout has recurrent episodes of acute flare. Acute flares typically occur fast. So simply speaking, you consume beer and in less than 24 hours you have excruciating pain in the foot. Acute flare resolves fast. Usually it takes less than 2 weeks for complete resolution of symptoms. So once acute flare is gone, everything comes back to normal until new acute flare develops. The next criteria is the presence of tophus. Here you see the description. Draining or chalk-like subcutaneous nodule. And also you see the most common sites where tophi can develop. Also, we have criteria related to laboratory values. First of all, the higher the uric acid level, the higher the risk of gout. Because, as we know, high uric acid level is absolutely essential for gout to develop. Also, we should determine uric acid crystals, because they are the hallmark of gout, and as we know, on joint aspiration they have needle shape and also they have negative birefringence. To diagnose gout we use ultrasound, and we have two major ultrasound criteria. On the first picture we see femoral cortex, and between bones we see cartilage. What is abnormal here is the second line, which should be absent. This line is created by deposition of urate crystals, and the presence of the second line around cartilage we call double contour sign, which is a hallmark of gout. On the second picture we see tendons, and under the tendons we see massive deposition of uric acid crystals that form tophi, and as we know, the presence of tophi is the hallmark of gout. The most modern method in gout diagnosis called dual energy CT. Basically, this method gives uric acid crystals a green color. So now we can visualize them much better. So on both these pictures, in different projections, we see deposition of uric acid crystals. So the quality of dual energy CT provides very accurate assessment of uric acid deposition. In addition to dual energy CT criteria, we also have X-ray criteria. For example, here we see juxtaarticular erosions, and inside and around erosion we see deposition of uric acid in form of tophus. Also, as we see, there is normal joint space, so cartilage is not affected here, unlike rheumatoid arthritis for example. On the second image, we also see juxtaarticular erosions with tophus. So the presence of both these features are considered as markers of gout-related joint damage, and thereby they are present in gout criteria. To make a diagnosis of gout, we need more than 8 points. The therapy of gout in acute flare and in chronic phase is completely different. First of all, about acute flare. In acute flare and for prophylaxis of acute flare, up to this day, as the first option, we use colchicine. Usually, we use colchicine in combination with glucocorticosteroids and non-steroidal anti-inflammatory agents. As alternative options, we have modern interleukin-1 inhibitors. They are selective but not that potent agents. And also we use corticotropin. All these drugs belong to different groups, but they have similar effect on acute flare. Colchicine and glucocorticosteroids decrease the production of pro-inflammatory cytokines. Non-steroidal anti-inflammatory agents decrease the severity of inflammation by inhibition of prostaglandins production in site of inflammation. And interleukin-1 inhibitors block the effect of interleukin-1 on neutrophils. So basically, all these drugs decrease the severity of inflammation. And the less severe is the inflammation, the less severe will be the clinical symptoms. So in acute flare, our goal is to decrease the severity of inflammation. In acute phase, we do not try to decrease uric acid level. We will decrease uric acid level, but only after the resolution of inflammation. But in chronic phase, our goal is to decrease uric acid level. By far the most popular drugs are xanthine oxidase inhibitors. It's allopurinol and febuxostat. Allopurinol and febuxostat both inhibit xanthine oxidase enzyme. The lower is the function of xanthine oxidase, the lower is the uric acid production. So by this, the amount of uric acid in the blood progressively decreases, and thereby the risk of gout complications decrease. The next two drugs, benzbromarone and probenecid, inhibit uric acid reabsorption in the kidney tubules, or we can say they increase uric acid excretion. Probenecid inhibits uric acid transporter 1. With inhibition of uric acid transporter, the reabsorption of uric acid decreases. Thereby, the amount of uric acid in the blood will decrease. Also, we have drugs called risburicase and pegloticase. They both convert uric acid to a more water-soluble molecules. And the higher the solubility of the molecule, the lesser is the chance that this molecule will bind to another molecule and form crystal. So they both decrease crystallization. So risburicase is actually an enzyme called urate oxidase. Risburicase provides oxidation of uric acid to allantoin. And the reason why allantoin is better than uric acid, it's because allantoin is much more water-soluble molecule. And the more water-soluble is the molecule, the lesser is the precipitation rate, and thereby the slower is the rate of crystals formation. And also, the more water-soluble is the molecule, the more rapidly kidneys can excrete it. So allopurinol, febuxostat, probenecid, and risburicase, all these drugs decrease the concentration of uric acid in the blood. The lesser is the amount of uric acid, the lesser will be the amount of uric acid crystals. Thereby, the risk of uric acid stones will decrease, and also the rate of tophi formation will decrease. With decrease in concentration of uric acid crystals, the probability of inflammasome activation decreases, and without inflammasome activation, acute flare will not develop. So by regulation of uric acid level in the blood, we can decrease the risk of acute flare. Also, we have to know that if person has gout and hypertension, the drug of choice for hypertension in this case is losartan, simply because losartan provides decrease in blood pressure and decrease in uric acid concentration in the blood. And the most important feature is that gout is very dependent on diet. So in order to prevent tophi formation and to avoid acute flare, a person should be on a very strict diet. It's definitely the most important feature in treatment of gout.